Dame Maggie Teyte was not only one of the most remarkable singers of her time, but one whose private life was as mysterious and turbulent as her public career was long and varied. We're now broadcasting The Kingdom of ALLEMOND, The Life of Maggie Teyte, written by her grandnephew Gary O'Connor, with Anna Massey as Maggie Teyte. The narration is by Brian Haynes, and other parts are played by Brian Carroll and David Egan. The Kingdom of ALLEMOND.
In the grey light of an autumn morn, I came upon a silent pool, guarded all around by ancient trees, tall trees, dying trees, and part of a tower where birds and bats had made their home. From the middle of the pool spread the water lilies with large fan-like leaves, whereupon sat little green frogs, and dragonflies, darting from flower to flower, kept their eyes busy to and fro. Many years ago, I came here as a child. I bent down to pluck a lily and fell in for my pains. I was pulled out by my nurse, as green as the carpet that covered it. Little I knew at that time how my memory would return to the silent pool and the maiden who would cry beside it. As in the storybooks, Melisande is her name.
Those lines were written by Maggie Teyte, who in 1908 sang the role of Melisande in Maeterlinck and Debussy's Pelléas et Melisande and became one of the great Melisandes of operatic history. So deeply was she involved with the character that in an intriguingly strange and Maeterlinckian way, fate seemed to affect Maggie Teyte's life and fortune. Like all Maeterlinckian heroines, Melisande is a child woman, one of those dynamic little creatures whom he has told us are les enfants qui ne sont pas des enfants, children who are not just children. They're a type of womanhood that is at once frail and shy. All of them have the same tender naivete. All of them become suddenly obsessed with the passion of womanhood. All of them seem somehow to retain the dawn-like delicacy of the immature nature. Melisande is a mysterious person, difficult to comprehend. She appears to Gollow out of nowhere, and his questions solve nothing.
I was brought up in a secure middle-class home in Wolverhampton. My father was a wines and spirits merchant and a dedicated amateur pianist. My mother, who had Irish blood, had a pretty voice. I attended school at a local Catholic convent, and our lives were like many others, until one day in the year 1900, when I was 12 years old, we moved to London, to Adelphi Terrace, near the Strand, where my father had bought a hotel. Many of my numerous brothers and sisters had by now grown up and left home. Then my father died. The debts, which had threatened his business for some time, now made my mother and myself virtually penniless. One spring night in 1903, when I was 15, I sang at a charity concert in the Catholic Church of Corpus Christi in Maiden Lane.
The next number, I regret to say, is not in your program. A very young person will sing Tosti's Goodbye, though I'm sure that after you've heard her, no apologies will be needed. Miss Maggie Teyte.
What I then saw so enchanted me that when I began my accompaniment, I'm afraid I faltered over the first chords. From the back of the church, this simple, slight figure of a girl dressed in white moved forward to take up a position on the altar steps beside me. Nearer, too, I could see her hair was reddish auburn, thick and long, and her figure thin and dainty, with an almost roguish quality. That captivating boyishness might go far, I thought.
Aren't you going to begin?
I could not help picturing her at once in various operatic roles. Surely, I thought, she would be able to convey to perfection the sacrosanct quality of the virgin, the sexiness of the unawakened young girl, the trustfulness of the wife which invites male treachery.
For heaven's sake, do start. Please.
Start.
Terribly naked. I don't know whether it was the effect of my father's recent death, which had been stored up inside me and which suddenly found expression through this trite song. Whatever it was, I stood as if lost, helpless. The young man who played, and whose name I found out later was Walter Rubens, took me by the hand and led me from the altar to the sacristy. I followed. I was completely dazed. And when we reached the sacristy, he began walking up and down and seemed to be saying, "Extraordinary, extraordinary." Then my ears became unblocked. Suddenly I was aware of the deafening applause in the church.
And so it was, extraordinary. It was the vulnerability, I suppose. She was so frail, so mysterious. Where had she come from? Who was she? There was something about her which was foreboding, almost violent.
I was a realist, too. I knew my limitations. I was born in Wolverhampton, remember? I was not going to lose my head, even though Walter lived in Millionaire's Row and his rich and influential friends were full of praise for my voice. No, I behaved myself impeccably, and they adopted me as one of their own. A purse of £1,000 was collected, a lot of money for those days, and I was taken by Walter and his mother to Paris to study with Jean Dereschke, the greatest tenor, and, much more important from my point of view, the greatest singing teacher of his day.
In the theater, one wants all kind of resource and color in the voice, but primarily power. In the theater, you have to shout, but you have to know how to shout. If you want to sing a difficult aria, learn one more difficult.
He stretched my voice. He established a proper connection between my voice and my breath support. He taught by exaggeration. You must have too much to have enough, he said. Above all, he put the emphasis on obtaining a natural effect.
But why in such a hurry? Take your time. Sing as though you were improvising it. It gives you authority over the stage, over the orchestra, over the audience. You compel them to wait for you, to pay attention to you.
I had a struggle to learn coloratura, but in time I learned to formulate high notes which were as perfect as I could make them. Clean and beautiful. A combination of soap and a very expensive hair tonic. We pupils would nervously assemble in the hall in the morning. First, Madame Dereschke would shout to the valet de chambre not to forget Monsieur's châle noir and to put it round him in case of a courant d'air. Then, at the head of the stairs, the procession would appear, the valet de chambre first, carrying the cage of Dereschke's parrot, Coco, then the maître. Now, a portly and bald middle-aged man, far removed from the great romantic Tristan of former years, Coco would be sitting on his shoulders. Then followed his Polish valet, a dachshund on one arm, while with the other he would try to balance the black shawl on Jean's shoulders, which he resisted in voluble Polish. During lessons, the parrot would stroll or flap about, happily taking nips at our ankles, and if a lesson was going badly, he would emit a peculiar cry, like a tenor in distress. A singer's life had to be balanced. There was the outside world. To me, oh, Paris was a fairyland. The Champs-Élysées was still a dignified residential avenue where every afternoon a stream of elegant open carriages and fiacres with tinkling bells swept down towards the rond-point. I was always amazed at the number of maternity homes that were advertised in large gilt signs. And yet, Paris's population was falling.
Je ne veux pas avec rien qui m'entraîne dans le ciel. Il me faut faire de Paris. trompe de lieu sans frise. Picarde, ça va l'ancien. Il n'est bon mec que le papa. Grâce aux dames parisiennes, de bien parler, donner le prix. Quoi qu'on dise,
François Villon wrote in that poem, which was set by Claude Debussy, there were no talkers like the women of Paris. I soon learned, too, that the French woman could flirt more easily and delightfully than any other woman in the world. I don't say that she could make love better, for I'm not prepared to say anything about that. But in the narrow borderline that lay between passion and indifference, the French woman reigned supreme. She had a delicacy, an exquisite tact, that would guide a flirtation over ice of the thinnest. She had a way of looking, a smile, a droop of the eyelash, a glance that was irresistible. Yes, the French woman taught me a great deal.
Towards the end of 1903, the composer and conductor Rinaldo Hahn came to Dureschke's school to choose a Zerlina and a Cherubino for a series of concerts he was devising as a Mozart festival.
If Dureschke was my first mentor, Rinaldo was the second. He was very good-looking, with brilliantly expressive, velvety eyes. We women were much enamored of the velvet quality in men's eyes. Fine brown hair and very dashing pencil-stub moustaches. On the tall side, he turned women's heads easily, in particular that of the ravishing Liane de Pougy, who spilled out to him all her sexual confidences. "You are the only man to whom I would like to give myself," she wrote to him, "and who will not take me." Even that invitation failed to stir him, because it was his affair with Marcel Proust which overshadowed all attractions he might have found in the opposite sex. Proust described him in his chronique.
A cigarette dangling from his lips, the company falls silent, gathers round, listens. Every note is either a word or a cry. The head is tilted back slightly, and from the melancholy mouth, almost disdainfully, comes the saddest and warmest sound that ever was.
Par les blanches nuits d'étoiles, dans la brise qui caresse ses longs voiles, sa mouvante chevelure et ses ailes de nuit-longue qui volent vive sur les
Maggie Teyte made her concert debut singing Cherubino with Lily Lehman at the Nouveau Théâtre in the Rue Blanche in March 1906. There were many exquisite gowns and beautiful women, wrote a member of the audience. Teyte is very tiny and is only 16 or 17. She wore a short white frock and white ribbons on her long braid. She was exquisite and was greeted with storms of applause. The contrast between her and Lehman was pathetic. Lehman is 60 years old and has her wonderful art left, with no voice to speak of, while Teyte has a fresh, young, exquisite voice with extremely childish interpretations. Lehman evidently felt the comparison, for she made the effort of her life to sing. But Maggie never recorded a Mozart aria until 46 years later, when Voi che sapete was pirated by an American record company from a radio broadcast.
Richard,
riusciremo senza volare, anche se saremo senza papà. Non trovo pace, non ti dici, ma fermi più.
Who conducted these Mozart concerts was not the only great figure of the Belle Epoque. There was Gabriel Fauré, whom she called the perfect charming gentleman with white hair, and whom she met at the Princesse de Polignac salon one tea time, where she sang Soir for him. There was Maurice Ravel, Fauré's pupil and a noted hypochondriac. And on the same day as she encountered Ravel at the famous music publisher's Durand, she met Puccini.
Solo mi fa il pranzo da me stessa, andado sempre a messa. Ma prego assai il Signor, vivo sola, soletta. Lei non bianca cameretta, guardo sui tetti, in cielo.
And they all said something nice about her singing, but she never bothered much with compliments. She had a brief and passing affair with George Enescu, the Romanian composer and violinist who became the teacher of Yehudi Menuhin. He dedicated one of his Sept Chansons de Clément Marot to her.
I didn't tell anyone of this affair because I wouldn't want them to say, oh, Tate, she was a real little prostitute. She'd go to bed with anybody.
She sang duets with Charles Gilibert, with Enrico Caruso, with John McCormack, with Edmond Clément, with Hector Dufresne, with Maurice Renault. But it wasn't until September 1907 that she had a summons connecting her again with that early autumn morning in her life when she'd stood on the edge of that silent pool in Wolverhampton looking into the water.
At the age of 18, very small and slight, I found myself on Debussy's doorstep with the score of Pelléas under my arm. He was living then in the house off the Avenue de Bois de Boulogne, which backed onto the Ceinture, the railway that runs all round Paris. It must have been a noisy situation for a composer, and indeed one of Debussy's critics said, oh, now I understand why his music is such a beastly noise. Well, I rang the bell and was shown into the salon. My chief remembrance of it was a collection of china cats. Some 12 or 15 of all shapes, sizes, and colors. I had plenty of time to look at them. I learned later there wasn't a live cat in the house because Debussy kept me waiting 15 minutes before he came in.
Debussy's own movements were cat-like, and for Maeterlinck, the cat was a symbol of Debussy. When the two men had quarreled over the first performance of Pelléas et Mélisande in 1902, Maeterlinck challenged Debussy to a duel, and one morning, when practicing for this, shot dead his own black cat. Before the opera's first performance, Maeterlinck had written to Le Figaro, expressing his hope for the resounding failure of a play which is no longer mine.
Debussy walked straight across the room to a little upright piano and sat down. Not once did he even so much as glance at me, but I had a good look at him. He seemed tall, but thick and heavy, and he slouched rather than walked. He had a black beard and a square head covered with black hair. It struck me he had an almost oriental look. He said to me, "I will have Melisande as I want her."
Maggie rehearsed with Debussy every afternoon for 2 hours, sometimes three.
He never played without first getting into the mood. This took 2 or 3 minutes. He raised his arms and was just getting ready to play when he saw a little bit of white cotton on the floor. He stopped and picked it up. Then again, he concentrated. Dead silence for another 5 minutes. His whole body went still. Himself wrote the words of that song. The flowers entwine my heart with their wicked stems. The sun, friend of evil flowers, killer of dreams. My soul is dying from too much sun. And throughout the part of Melisande, there runs this fear of the light, this obsession with darkness, with evil, but above all, with truth. Where does she come from? When at the beginning of the opera, she is found by the lake about to drown herself. Maeterlinck never tells us. Only from other sources do we learn she was one of the wives of Bluebeard, whose cruelty and rape made her flee his castle. Later, when she's married to Golo, she doesn't tell him the truth about her love for his half-brother Peleas, and Golo has to find out for himself. Even then, he is not satisfied. Even after he has killed Peleas, he wants to know more. Vite, vite, la vérité, la vérité. Then, at the end, when she is dying, the truth comes out that she has given birth to a daughter. Another mystery.
It was from this period spent with Debussy that she began her lifelong identification with Melisande. Maggie Teyte, born in Wolverhampton, changed both the spelling of her name and her nationality in Paris. Her name had been spelt T-A-T-E, but on de Reschke's advice, she changed it to T-E-Y-T-E. On the 16th of October, 1909, she married a French lawyer whose name was Eugène Plumont, 20 years her senior. Here now was the galop of her life, the protector with the child wife. She became, to all intents and purposes, a Frenchwoman.
Eugène's companions called him a cradle snatcher. Once, he was escorting me down the Unter den Linden in Berlin. I was singing there at the Imperial Opera, when a flirtatious young Prussian officer who was passing took him to be my father and made a proposition. Eugène tore a strip off the officer, but next day, the officer sent round his seconds to the hotel, challenging Eugène to a duel. We left at once. He arranged my contracts, he collected my fees, he gave musicale to promote my talents. He even stood in for me once when I had a bad cold, as a conjurer, at a concert in aid of the Forest Row Cricket Club.
According to the East Sussex Gazette, June 12, 1912, I give a number of remarkably clever and cleanly executed conjuring tricks. One, in which I turned the waistcoat of a member of the audience inside out, without removing the coat, was provocative of much mirth. My smart display of coin and card manipulation left the audience gasping for breath.
He conjured with my sexuality, too. For a while, I was the perfect object for him to own, to manage, combining the attributes of the girl mistress with those of the sexual connoisseur. But he went too far. He convinced me that I should become sterilized, a fashionable operation at that time.
But the spirit of independence of La Dame Plumont, as Maggie was now known, rebelled. Eugène's sense of truth was not strong enough for her. Vérité, 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 it ran through her life like an obsession. One night after they'd returned home from a supper party, she asked,
"Why did you lie to that man at supper? What was his name? Some friend of Rinaldo's?"
"Oh, I didn't want to hurt him, poor fellow. He is a nice enough chap. I knew his mother and father."
"You should have told him what you thought. He respects having the truth told him."
"Oh, ma chère Maggie, you are uncouth. You must flatter people's ideas of themselves, else you will lose a lot of friends."
"I have no friends. A young soprano is alone in this world. I will never make a friend in the opera house until I have made my name."
"You have me."
"What good are you? You never tell the truth."
"But I protect you from the worst in yourself. A certain tendency towards vulgarité. It is very English."
"So you want me to lie? You dare actually encourage it? Lie, lie, lie."
"It is the very fabric of which the world of the performer is constructed."
"Oh, get out. Leave me on my own."
"No, no, no. Look, please, you don't understand. In no way did I mean to cast a reflection on the truth quality of your art."
"Get out. You disgust me. You're a coward. That's why you wanted no children. You think by getting me to agree to that dreadful operation, you could have me always for your own uninterrupted pleasure."
"You don't understand, my darling child."
"I do. You're always guarding your little prima donna as if I lived in your pocket. You take me out to lunch, you meet me at the opera house. Don't you see? You're suffocating
me." "But you need me. Where would you be otherwise? You were a waif. You arrived as if from nowhere. Monsieur Carré, the director of the Opéra Comique, tried to take you to bed. Monsieur Gunsberg of the Monte Carlo Opera House struck you off his list to a gala dinner in Saint-Saëns honneur because you refused to sleep with him."
"Would have been better if I'd let them all have their way. Would have made me more tough."
"You are too good for them. You belong to..."
"No one but myself."
"Exactly."
"You see, you're even lying now. You had been going to say my art."
"But you are a vulnerable person. You need marriage, a husband."
"A child."
"Your career is your child. Our child."
"It's no good. I'm leaving for America alone. Marriage is not for serious artists."
"Very sorry. Toi, moi, et moi, moi aussi, après toi. Vive pour la vérité, vive pour enfin la vérité, entends-tu? Dis-moi tout, je ne te pardonne tout. Tu le sais maintenant, il est temps, vive, vive, la vérité, la vérité.
Maggie and Plumont were divorced in November 1915. The divorce and costs awarded against Maggie. She was now making a big success in America. In Boston, in San Francisco, in Chicago, in Philadelphia, in New York. She flitted about brilliantly from place to place, like a hummingbird, never staying in one place for very long. The Americans were enchanted with her, coining for her the title Pocket Prima Donna.
A mite of a soprano with a voice four times as large as she is. Madame Tetrazzini is the size of three or four Maggie Tates.
Yet little Maggie Tate received almost as great an ovation for her Cherubino as Tetrazzini had for Lucia.
She sang Cinderella in the American premiere of Massenet's Cendrillon opposite Mary Garton. She sang Ligia in Jean Nugges's Quo Vadis. Dot Peerybingle in Goldmark's The Cricket on the Hearth, based on the story by Charles Dickens. She sang Butterfly, Mimi in La Boheme, Desdemona in Otello, Marguerite in Faust, Gilda in Rigoletto. She sang recitals of British songs, of American songs, of French songs.
But why did America not see the slender Melisande, of whom it was said that Debussy's very thought found an echo in the voice of his faithful interpreter, and of whom Debussy himself said, "She does not act Melisande. She is Melisande."
When I was a young girl at St. Joseph's Convent, Wolverhampton, I was one of 30, filing into the refectory for breakfast. On the floor lay the portrait of an elderly gentleman, a benefactor of the convent, which had fallen from the wall. Well, the only Irish girl in the group exclaimed, "That means bad news." Well, 2 days later, a cable arrived from America to say that her brother and last surviving relative had suddenly died. She was wearing a green dress on that occasion, and I shall never forget her crying out, "I'll never wear green again." I remained superstitious. In 1917, when I was in New York, I was taken to have my horoscope read by the famous clairvoyant Evangeline Adams. Now, she foretold my marriage to a tall, dark, handsome young man. And on the 12th of March, 1921, now in London, I did marry for a second time. My husband was the Canadian paint millionaire Sherwin Cottingham, whose father had expanded the Berger paint business into a worldwide concern. Oh, he was so beautiful. I was surprised he ever looked at me. It was a case of love at first sight. The warm radiance, the gentle sadness of a dream, clung to our first meeting. We were made for one another. We walked blindly to our tryst with fate.
Je viens souvent m'asseoir ici vers midi, lorsqu'il fait trop chaud dans les jardins. On étouffe aujourd'hui même à l'ombre des arbres. Elle est fraîche comme l'hiver. C'est une vieille fontaine abandonnée. Il paraît que c'était une fontaine miraculeuse. Elle ouvrait les yeux des aveugles. On l'appelle encore la fontaine des aveugles. Le roi est presque aveugle lui-même. On n'y vient plus.
On est seul ici. On entend
rien. Il y a toujours un silence extraordinaire. On entendrait dormir l'eau. Voulez-vous vous asseoir au bord du bassin de marbre? Il y a un tilleul où le soleil n'entre jamais.
Je vais me coucher sur le marbre, je voudrais voir le fond de l'eau.
On ne l'a jamais vue, elle
était peut-être aussi profonde que la mer.
Si quelque chose a pris de fond, mon âme a répété.
Franchement sensible,
je voudrais toucher le fond.
Prenez garde de glisser, je vais vous tenir par la main.
Sherwin also settled some of my outstanding debts, and we moved to Maidenhead, to an estate which for me became also a mythical region, a kingdom of Allemond, planted with exotic and noble trees. And here, for several years, I retired from singing and enjoyed a life of complete luxury. The atmosphere of our marriage was drenched in exquisite and agonizing expectation. Life in our romantic kingdom of Allemond, otherwise known as Woolley Grange, Littlewick Green, Berkshire, lasted as long, possibly, as any life conducted according to the old highways of love could last. We played tennis, we played golf, we entertained royally. Sherwin had, however, been wounded in the First War, when, as a balloon officer, he had been shot down over France. To lessen the pain, he drank. And as he drank more and more, so he lost self-confidence. At first, I helped him all I could. I sat by his bedside when he went for treatment in Bournemouth. But then, little by little, everything changed. I found I grew more exacting and even contemptuous of his drinking, which I couldn't cure. I grew to hate his cronies. I pity you.
Oh, yeah? Pity me, do you?
I feel sorry for people who can't sing.
Maggie, why do you look at me like that?
He started to suspect the servants were talking about him behind his back. He had given up going to London, where he had an office. He had no child or heir, because I could not have children. I tried to have my sterilization operation reversed, but fate thwarted me in this, and the new operation failed.
Then in 1930 came an event as crucial to the second half of Maggie Tate's life as the death of her own father had been to the first.
Evangeline Adams foretold that 1928 would be a lucky year for me. Alas, it was in the spring of that year that I decided to be tied no longer to all my silly superstitions, and I bought myself an evening gown of a lovely shade of olive green. We red-headed women are vain, and to enhance the charm that red hair is supposed to have for the opposite sex, many of us like to wear green. But there are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. And it was that same year that I began to realize my marriage was breaking up. I remained in this troubled state until 1990, when one evening, returning to my music room, I found there a bird fluttering to escape. 2 days later, my father-in-law died. This event caused the end of my married life.
Cottingham had met another woman, a slender Russian beauty born in Kiev, who frequented the baccarat halls of continental resorts and with whom he began an affair. She ultimately brought to him a child. Just over 4 years later, Cottingham died. Pelléas was dead, not by a sudden jealous blow, but from equally dramatic causes. War, infidelity, and drink.
The season of lilac and roses will return no more this spring. The season of lilac and roses is over. The season of pinks, too. The wind has changed. The skies are sullen, and no more shall we run and gather the lilac in bloom and the lovely roses. The springtime is sad and cannot blossom. Moment in my life when I had to decide between love and companionship, or music and solitude. I chose the solitude. The other could never have made up for that void of music.
This choice came when she was just 50. It coincided with her leaving her beloved Woolley Grange, where she'd now lived for 17 years, and which, after Cottingham's death, was put up for sale.
Towards the end of the 30s, my career was still in the doldrums, and my private life hardly inspiring. But fate sent along its rescuer, a true deus ex machina, the machine being the gramophone. The god's name was Joe Brogan, and his intervention galvanized my work and laid the basis for future success. Of Scots-Irish blood, Brogan had emigrated to the States from Scotland, and he started the gramophone shop in New York, which grew to near legendary proportions, so that he could boast among his customers the Mikado and the Maharaja of Mysore. Around 1935, Brogan tried to interest the Victor Record Company in New York in the idea of recording an album of my Debussy repertoire. Finally, 7 double-sided discs were made in London, with Alfred Cortot as accompanist. The album was an immense success.
She had had lovers during these unhappy years. An affair with Sir Thomas Beecham, begun in London before the First War, was resumed for a while. There were others. Her view of men worsened considerably. Yet into the recording she made in the next 10 years, she managed to pour, in distilled shape, her own emotions, disciplining and purging them, and exalting them. Her early perception and memory of the composers of the Belle Epoque set a standard. She began to explain what she'd hitherto only known by instinct. She would now deliver sound advice to other singers.
Many people will regret losing the bad as it denotes for them an emotional outlet. I advise you all to learn Mozart. Bad artists use sexy behavior to hide the gaps in their artistic temperament.
She never lost her outspoken humor.
Too many conductors in Anglo-Saxon countries look upon singers as congenital idiots. Except, of course, foreign artists, who come backed by lots of press glamour. But at least we singers know our roles by heart, which few conductors seem to have the capacity to achieve. Either they twist and twirl their arms in the air like windmills, jump up and down like monkeys on sticks to attract attention to themselves, or they have their noses glued to the score and fail to give a beat at all.
Throughout the war, she gave concerts for ENSA and for the French Committee of National Liberation, for which she was decorated by de Gaulle. And after it, as she approached the age of 60, when most other prima donnas have long since retired, her career hit a new peak. She was asked to sing Mélisande at the New York City Center. So she settled in New York, in a penthouse at the top of an apartment block which she'd nicknamed Mélisande's Tower. It was dominated by the building's huge water tank, itself surrounded by the shadows of roof garden trees, a grotesque city parody of the forest and lakeside tableau from Pelléas et Mélisande.
Oh, this place is really fascinating, and I consider myself very lucky to have found it. It is the first time I've ever made something to my own liking.
Time has left her the ingenuous, forlorn little princess of Maeterlinck and Debussy's dream, a reviewer had written 20 years before in 1930, when she sang the role of Mélisande at Covent Garden. Now in the Indian summer of her career, her looks had definitely hardened. An inner vulnerability remained, but it was no longer to be seen in the face.
Sorry, maestro,
she interrupted the conductor Jean Morel one rehearsal at City Center.
You are losing the story. You have to give the full value to Maeterlinck's Pelléas et Mélisande.
The critics were as ecstatic over her as they had been over that slim, roguish figure of a girl who had enchanted them 47 years before.
Oh, oh, toutes les étoiles tombent.
Sur moi aussi.
Encore, donne.
Tout.
Donne.
She sees her lover killed before her eyes and thrown into the well and subsides back into numbness. She goes back into the shadows, into loss of memory, confusion and bewilderment, as on her deathbed after the miscarriage she sings, I no longer understand all I am saying. I don't know what I am saying. I don't know what I know. I no longer say what I want. I don't know. Arkell speaks her epitaph. Just another mysterious thing like everyone else. And she dies in mystery, as she had begun.
Great woman singer dies no less than three times. First go her looks, that is the first death, then her voice, the second death. And finally, there is the death these rare and unearthly creatures share with the rest of us. Kirsten Flagstaff, with whom Maggie Tate sang her last operatic performance as Belinda in Dido and Aeneas at the Mermaid Theatre, London, bluntly averred, "I might as well be dead when I finally retire from opera and concert work." For Tate, the process of dying in all three aspects was mysterious, protracted, and painful. She'd wanted to arrive on the stage of life as Melisande arrived, a mystery totally unexplained, something dark, something fascinating behind her. Then, like Melisande, after Golo's jealousy had reared up, she was sent back into the shadows, back into numbness, and then death.
I'm going to divest myself of everything. I don't want anything around me but gin. I'm not going to be polite to anyone. I'm 81. I'm not used to being old.
She sold up everything, but she was to live another 7 years, moving from nursing home to nursing home while health deteriorated and financial stability grew more and more precarious.
I'm very snobbish and very vain. If I can't go back as a prima donna, I won't go back. I can't make money. I want to give cocktail parties, and I haven't got a place of my own. No, I don't want to go back. Raping world, this copulating world. I don't want to have anything to do with it. We had the best of it. 1919, 1920. We had a wonderful time.
Her art had taken too much out of her. Muse demands all, she was always saying. It may be that her fate was now intent on teaching her a lesson. She said at this time, "I'm going to learn patience." And while this was above all not easy for Maggie Tate to learn, it was astonishing that in these trials she should be seeking a knowledge and a moral self-advancement that previously she'd been all too reluctant to value.